To extend a hearty welcome to all the students, scholars, and teachers of philosophy across the country to be connected with us in this students' webinar. On 26th December, we conducted the students' webinar, in which five UG students and six research scholars joined as participants, and their presence made the webinar series successful and very meaningful. Today we have with us six participants today, and they belong to both the UG and the PG. Two students are from PG standard and four students belong to UG standard. They are Ms. Ankita Poddar, Ms. Smriti Rekha Naik, Ms. Jyoti Biswas, Ms. Barsha Bisoi, Ms. Lakshmipriya Ghatwali, and Ms. Subhashi Ratra. I welcome all of them to today's webinar. Today we have with us the respected judges, Professor Paresh Chandra Das sir, Professor Anup Rai sir, Professor Dr. K. Omnal Rao sir, and I also welcome all the sponsors of this students' webinar program. On this occasion, I welcome to our admini and supervisor of all the papers and the man behind, the main architect of the entire program, Professor Pramod Kumar Das of Noyagarh Autonomous College, Noyagarh. I welcome him. With this, I also welcome all the senior teachers to be connected with this virtual academic program. On this occasion, it's time to call upon the first presenter of today's webinar, Ms. Ankita Poddar. Ms. Ankita Poddar is a PG student from NL Philosophy. May I welcome and invite Ms. Ankita Poddar to present her scheduled topic, Ethics in Bhagavad Gita. Ethics in Indian philosophy. Over to Ms. Ankita.
Pranam to the all respected judges and teachers and the members, and wish you all the happy new year and prosperous peace to the all. Myself, Ankita Poddar, I am coming from Damdam, Kolkata. First of all, I want to thank philosophy family for giving me so wonderful opportunity to explain my own thought on this topic. And then I want to thank Dr. Pramod Kumar Das sir for guiding me such a wonderful manner. And with the respect and with permission of the all respected judges, I should start my paper. Today my topic is Ethics in Indian Philosophy and Analytical Reflection. In this paper, I shall try to elucidate how ethics as a moral science and philosophy as an analytic reflection both are not limited to theoretical discussion of the intellectuals, rather rooted in the facts of human life and transforming man to the highest possibility of perception. The irony is the fact that man has become the center of all discussions, the measure of everything and the standard of all ethical paradigms. But human life is ignored in this process. Man is running after the worldly prosperity, and in support of the justification, they follow the suitable philosophy and ethics. As a result, man becomes a hedonist, a rationalist, a materialist, and so on. The purpose of human life is to become a man, as it is prescribed in the Rig Veda, Manur Bhava, be a man. The prescription is not an appreciation. This is a very strong instruction to man to become man, as there is possibility in man to behave like a non-human. The provisions of ethical code of living, rules, the police stations, the judiciary, and the jail custody are only designed for human beings. Except man, all other creatures act according to the natural orders. Man deviates because man is rational. Man deviates because man can apply reason. Man deviates because man knows how to justify ethics by reason. This is the crisis when reason justifies moral standards and moral activities. Man takes advantage of all these justifications. So, Theoretical analysis of ethical values does not have any effect in the practical life of man, unless and until they are lived in life and used for life transformation. Similarly, philosophy is not confined to analysis. Analytical activities help understanding and getting clarity in semantic meaning of the concepts. That is useful but not adequate. In India, philosophy is called darshana or the vision of truth. The truth cannot be visualized in the concepts and in the process of their linguistic analysis. Vision of truth is possible by the experience of the truth through inner realization. This inner realization leads to actual transformation of life. So, besides the theoretical foundation of ethics and analytical exercise of philosophy, both ethics and philosophy contribute human life in the noblest task of transformation. Ethics undertake a systematic study of values and therefore is concerned with human behavior. Ethics studies both customary and cardinal values. Customary values are relative, whereas cardinal values are universal. For example, social norms associated with marriage vary from society to society. Similarly, the values of pertaining to the religious observances vary from religion to religion. The customary values vary with time, situation, and persons. The notion of vice and virtue based on these social values, which are bound to be relative. Laws and enactments, prescriptions and prohibitions are framed, keeping the individual or the privileged few in view but not the society. So-called social values have benefited the selected few but not the mass. In fact, ethics in different eras turned out to be the class ethics. The social values were determined by the collective psychology. They were not humanistic. Values today having been based on certain decent faiths and dogmas are mostly anti-human. Hence, there is the necessity of reformulating customary morality by an appeal to the basic human values. This point to the imperative to restructure the value system on the basis of human cardinal principles. In Indian philosophy, morality is considered as a living force. Moral principles are regulative in nature. They guide man along the path of righteousness, leading to the attainment of the cosmic states. These scriptures that tend to divide human society and regiment human mind are not worth the name. Scripture is that which liberates the individual by right discipline. So, philosophy in the true sense should guide ethics for the highest benefit of human life. Indian philosophy gives equal importance to both metaphysics and ethics and aims at the finest transformation of human life. In Indian philosophy, moral order is interchangeably used with the cosmic order, which is known as Rita. Rita is conceived as the presiding principle in which the cosmos is poised and the power by which is regulated. Rita is the unchanging universal being, the changing particulars, the eternal behind the ephemeral. The unalterable nature of Rita is termed as Satya or Truth. This truth is defined as the non-sublimatable or Satyam Abhaditam. Here, Rita is used in the sense of Dharma, which means to uphold or sustain. It is the fact that the forces of nature rule according to Dharma. Dharma always come out victorious. It means that whosoever follows the way of the cosmic order or Dharma is bound to be rewarded with victory. The moral order is irrevocable. Hence, the ultimate well-being of the individual and society consists in living in obedience to it. Those who protect dharma or righteousness are protected by it. The Bhagavad Gita has given importance on the visual declaration of dharma according to one's linguistic qualification. People belonging to different varnas, quality and ability can promote the cause of collective good only by discharging their respective duties or swadharma. Swadharma literally means one's own dharma. In this sense, it means the duty of a person or a class of a person of particular one. People differing in respect of color physiognomy may share a common psychophysical makeup or called shabhava. Swadharma is grounded in shabhava. What one ought to do largely depends upon what one is most disposed for and best capable of. Swadharma is determined by person contingencies on the hand of shabhava and contextual contingencies, space and time, on the other hand. But the contingencies are taken into account only with one end in view, and that is lokasangraha, the well-being of all. Swadharma being relative to time, place and person. This does not infect dharma with relativism. Thus, Indian philosophy justifies both the absolutistic and relativistic perspective of the moral order without committing any logical oddity. Here, I shall discuss ethics in Indian philosophy from the perspective of ethical postulates. According to Immanuel Kant, there are three postulates of morality, such as the existence of God, immortality of soul, and the freedom of will. Kant postulated three things that were necessary for ethical theories work. We must be free to be able to make decisions. There must be an afterlife or immortality for us to be able to achieve the summum bonum. We must have a strong faith in the existence of God to be able to follow the path of righteousness. Here I shall submit that Indian philosophy does not entertain these postulates, morality as the necessary condition of being ethical. The ethical pursuit is autonomous. The ethical values are intrinsic. Ethics has no necessary relation with both the postulates of the existence of God and the immortality of soul. Both theism and atheism are crucial to ethical paradigms. The Buddha, the Jaina, and the early Shankhya do not believe in the existence of God, but they all preach the ethical value of human life. Buddha does not believe in the existence of God and existence of soul and its immortality, but he has preached the eightfold path or ethical value of human life. Similarly, the postulates of human being or the freedom of will is discussed in Indian philosophy in a very wider perspective. The freedom of human will is through the strong determinism. Human will is determined as well as free. Our past habits determine and influence our course of action. Man is not absolutely free from his past disposition, and at the same time, man has freedom to change his destiny. Both the possibilities are postulated in Indian ethics. In that sense, Indian ethics is constructed as pragmatic gathering to the reality of bondage and aspiration of liberation. The transition from the state of bondage to the gradual freedom from bondage is the real transformation. So, Indian ethics is not gospel of doctrines, rather the manual of living a perfect life. The only postulate of morality in Indian philosophy is the protection of righteousness or dharma. Immanuel Kant also advocates the principle of the protection of righteousness, claiming that duty for the duty's sake. But Kant's categorical imperative is formal and logical, and therefore rigorous. In Indian philosophy, duty is performed not only for the sake of duty, but also with devotion. Performance of duty is not mechanical like an ATM machine. When a mother discharges her duties for her child, she does not duty with as a mechanic. She does it with love and affection. Duty plus love and affection makes a complete human personality. Devotion or love for duty should not be understood as moha or infatuation or psychic inclination for any ethical pageants. Devotion for duty leads to nishkama karma, and all such actions are meant to be loko shangraha. The blind pursuit of roles for the sake of roles or duty for the sake of duty does not yield social harmony. It rather makes one's personality stubborn and rigorous. Social harmony can be maintained by the synthesis of jnana, karma and bhakti. In the Bhagavad Gita, it is said as jnana karma bhakti samuchaya. Without right knowledge, duty shall lose its viability, and without devotion, duty shall lose its divinity. With devotion, duty becomes our charity or seva, and with knowledge, duty becomes our transformation. We should do our duty in the sense of yagya, and that duty shall never bind us. So, duty should be done in the sense of detachment and for the well-being of the society or lokushangha. With this, I conclude that philosophy and ethics complement each other in Indian way of life. By this, I completed my paper. Thank you.
Okay, thanks so much, Ms. Sangeeta, for a beautiful presentation on the scheduled topic. And Ankita, you have very beautifully elucidated how ethics is a moral science and philosophy, and how it is rooted in the facts of human life, and how the applying role of ethics is to transform man to its highest possibility. And you have taken ethics as a systematic study of all values, both customary values and the culinary values and absolute values, all kinds of values. In inner philosophy, you have also written how moral order is used as the cosmic order for the ultimate and individual well-being. You have taken Bhagavad Gita in your paper to use and to make up the Swadharma, Swabhava, Lokasangraha, and for social harmony. With it, you have also taken Kant's moral postulates in connection to Indian ethics. You have concluded how philosophy and ethics both complement each other in Indian way of life. Thanks so much for the beautiful presentation. Now over to Dr. K. Omnan Rao for moderating the question session. Over to Dr. Rao.
Thank you, Dr. Maharana, for briefly synopsizing the talk of Ankita. And I should also thank Ankita for a clear-cut presentation. Now, at first, I would like to request Dr. Kailashchandra Das sir to make his observations and put forth his questions to Ankita. Over to Dr. Das.
Thank you, Om Babu. I have very carefully listened to very clear and lucid paper of Gita. And I have one query to make, and I want her clarification. She has said about Swadharma, and she has said about how Indian philosophy and ethics are mutually interdependently progressed. But there is a point in which it is a complaint that there is no serious ethical discussion in Indian philosophical systems, the way we find in the West. Like, for example, we have rationalism, hedonism, perfectionism. We can brand like this. Also, we don't have something like normative ethics, meta-ethics, or practical ethics. You can find traces there, here and there, but no systematic discussion is done. Number two. Number three is, it is since Indian philosophy is giving primacy to what is the ultimate aim of life, samam gunam of life, that is enlightenment or something like that. But that is what is paramartha. But it is not so much about ethical excellence. So we'll see, clarify if I have made my point clear to Ankita. Amma, your view on this?
Yes, sir. Sir, I try to clear the justification. So, according to the summum bonum, whatever our Western philosophical ethics should be told that in Indian ethics, the ultimate goal of human life or ultimate goal of ethics are also should be explained, but they should be called as purusharthya or the ultimate goal of life. Purusharthya in sense there is a four, but there is a conflict in this four. Dharma, artha, moksha and kam. Dharma, which he has referred as Dhri Dhatu, which maintained as the mission is in this sense, that which conceived the authorization of ethics, and moksha, which can be achieved at the end of life or which can be achieved by reproach to the ultimate knowledge, and the others two, karma and dharma, artha, moksha and karma, the four others. So the two all others, the karma, the love, the affection, the ultimate passion, or artha, the vishaya, as vishaya or the money, or as whatever which can explain the ultimate needs of human beings. But above all of four days, our Indian philosophy should accept it more of all the most.
No. One intervention. I got it. You have nicely elaborated all these things. Purusharthas you have not dealt with, but you have said. No, thing is, when we are talking about ultimate aim, it is not talking about value, but about knowledge. So Indian philosophy gives a lot of importance, primacy to knowledge, wisdom, right? Enlightenment, certain things like that, not of value. Value is not given that importance the way they have given importance to knowledge. That is, avidya is removed and vidya we want. In most of the systems, they want all our sufferings is because of ignorance. So they are concerned about more about knowledge. So it is on an epistemological side is there, but value is neglected here. What you have to say about that? How do you justify that?
So value is not so much neglected in Indian ethics, according to my point of view, because if we see the Charvakas, they are always tolding about whatever they see and their own values. They don't focus on the epistemological or metaphysical way. They only focus about the perception, Rinang, Pribang, Ghitang, and I forgot the ultimate one. Sorry for that. But they always
Runang Krutta Grutam Pivet. Runang Krutta Grutam Pivet Javat Jivet Sukham Jivet.
Yes, sir. Thanking for completing my sloka. And according to them, the values are should be reached by human life whenever they whatever they want to do. Values are cannot be defined as the ethics according to others, or values cannot be defined what other told to us. Human should be do whatever they think that is greater for the self. Like the hedonism told, the Charvakas also can be explained as a hedonist on that sense. So in point of view, we have values and some of there, we also have the ethics in my sense.
Okay.
Okay, Ankita, well, so when a reference is made to values, how do you take Buddhism to describe Indian ethics?
So in Buddhism, they make an beautiful example that if anyone does not believe in the existence of God, they can also believe in the ethics or in the ethical view, because ethics is not a mechanical one or not a duty here explained as a duty. Buddhist, the Gautam Buddha can't postulate or believing in the existence of God, but he also explained the Eightfold Path, the way of Nirvana, as the way in ethics. He also given a light on Fourfold Path, Dadash Bhava Chakra, and how to a man can be covering themselves up from the postulates of sorrow and bondage and afterlife. So here in Buddhism, they can explain the notion of ethics in concept of nirvana, in concept of dadash bhava chakra, and so on.
No, my point is whether Buddha was focusing on the metaphysical issues or the social issues.
According to Buddha, Gautam Buddha, it should be metaphysics and the social issues are conflicted for there, because the sarvam duksham, all is bounded with sorrow. This sentence are explained at it can be a social issue, but it's also can be explained at Buddhism in a metaphysical way, like as pratita samutpada or satkaryavad, causal theory of cause, etc.
Okay, well, the post comments are reserved. Then anyway, I move to Professor Anup Rai sir for his questions.
Thank you, Ankita, for your nice presentation. It's a really nice paper. The difference between Indian and am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Difference between Indian philosophy, ethics, and Western is that Indians follow what they say. Their view of life goes with their way of life. You see the Jainas, they live as they say. But most of the time in Western philosophy, ethics or philosophy is a drawing room discussion. Talk about morality, but they actually don't, not necessarily they follow it, and in their real life. And about your Buddhism, actually Buddha always avoided metaphysical questions. He never talked of God. He never talked of soul. He says, he is one of the last words, be light unto thyself. His value system goes with Indian total system. I mean, when they are trying for knowledge, be there, they go with a value like In Buddha, they are Brahma Vihara. They have prescribed Brahma Vihara. Brahma Vihara are the ethical course, how to lead your life and how to get Nirvana. So Buddhists always very strictly follow ethical values. They have given importance, but it is not independently discussed. It discussed along with their seeking for right knowledge. Okay, thank you. But it's a very nice paper you have.
Thank you, sir.
Well, Ankita, one more issue that how do you take dharma? Yes, during towards the end of your presentation, you tried to say that in Indian ethics, dharma constitutes an important postulate of morality, and as I said, constitute an important value. Then, how do you take dharma in the Indian context?
So, in Indian context, dharma are explained here in the sense of dhri, when dharma is come from dhri dhatu, and here dharma is explained as a not as a duty. Like I want to tell here an explanation, whatever I also told in my paper. When a mother feed her child, that's not the mother's duty. Or here someone say it's matri dharma, but in this sense, yes, it is dharma. But this dharma is explained not as mechanical one. This dharma is explained as with love, with affection, with care. When our mother or when our family member take care of us when we are going to so ill, they don't do that with their duty, and though then they also don't think that that's their dharma. They do this because we talk they are all affections and care and love. But still, this is here explained as their swadharma, swabhav dharma. But this is not the duty. Here I want to make a differentiate between dharma and duty, which is very much important, I think, in Indian postulates of ethics. So dharma is what which taken all the postulates of moral ethics and the resemblance all the ethical values together, which dharan all the notions or all the characteristics of ethics, which is explained as Bhagavad Gita. And doing this dharma with so much spiritually and so much
okay, Ankita, fine, okay, done. And the last puja, and in few lines you just hint it out. Do you feel that there is an allegation, it's an allegation that in that Indian ethics has its basis in religion? How do you admit that Indian ethics has its basis in religion?
Not so much, because Indian ethics has its concept on religion, but it also make conceptual theories about the other religions. For here, religions is not as Hinduism. If I explain this, that Hinduism for Indian ethics and for me, Hinduism is explained because we are Indians, and this India word is coming from Hindustan, and this is also come because the Aryans are living in Jhelum Nadi Tir, or as the Sindhu Nad, who lives behind on the Sindhu Nad, they also called Sindhus, and after the time it should be called Hindus and then Indians, and these Hindus are going to be Hindus. So for me, Indian philosophy has respect to the all religions. If I give an example that a Muslim also give respect to the Hindus, the chadar which is in green color, which is used as Durga, is also used on Hindu Durga Puja. So in that sense, for me,
thank you Ankita. Okay, Kalasha, well, thank you Ankita for your presentation and your response. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Ankita, for briefly responding.